I want to introduce to you Carmelita. She has worked with me many, many years. We started together at KeyBank, and she was on my college recruiting team, so she has recruited across the country, and then I came here to Meijer to manage their corporate recruiting, and she was also on my team at Meijer to do a lot of the corporate recruiting for experienced hires. She still is at Meijer and is looked at as a thought leader and a really expert talent acquisition specialist. So she is going to give you the tools and trades that you need today. Please, in the end, ask her a lot of questions. When I say I know her well after working with her for years and she is legit, you want to really make sure that you use this opportunity, because it's not often that we get employers that will spend the entire day with us to make sure that we're successful. So without further ado, Carmelita Waller.
Good. Thank you so much for Tarita for the introduction, and thanks for having me here. I'm excited to be here to help you guys out. Before we get started, I just want to kind of get a gauge for what class levels we have in the room. So how many of you are freshmen? Okay, two freshmen. How many? Three freshmen. How many sophomore? Junior? Senior? How many of you don't even go here? Just happened to walk by and saw us gathering? Okay, good. So we're here to talk about, or I'm going to share with you, how to find internships and jobs. And so to start off, I kind of want to get a gauge for how much information you guys have already so that I can enhance the information that you already know and then add any value that I can add to that. So can I get a volunteer to be a scribe for me? Thank you very much. And so if you guys can just start shouting out, what are ways that you have in the past or that you know of to find internships or jobs?
Career fairs.
Huh?
Sorry, career fairs.
Know somebody, basically.
Know somebody, good. Anything else?
LinkedIn.
Anything else?
General internet searches.
Yep, general internet searches. Indeed.com, yes.
Company websites.
Yes, company websites.
There's monster.com, not to be mistaken.
Mm-hmm. Good. All right. That's a good list to start off with there. You guys are pretty informative. So good job on your end for knowing a lot of the tools that I'm going to talk about today. Thank you very much for your assistance. Okay, so the first on my list and what I always like to share with students is the Career Development Office. That's my number one recommendation to students when they ask about finding jobs or internships, is to connect with your career development office on campus. It's sad, really, the number of students that are on campuses that never walk into the career development office because they have so much information that can help you guys as students as you navigate through looking for jobs and internships. Why go at it alone and start from scratch and recreate the wheel and be out here, you know, all loosey-goosey trying to figure things out when you have a whole office? And I know Tarita is great at what she does. I've enjoyed working with her for many years, and I know she's passionate about what they do in her office. So why go at it alone when you have tools and resources at your fingertips that they're there to help you? That's what they do all day. So I always direct students to go to the Career Services office, be very in tune with what they have going on there. Seek their guidance and their assistance first and foremost, because they have access to employers, they have access to all the information that you guys need. So that's usually my first point of contact, would be to make sure to connect with the career fairs. With the career development offices. They're very in tune with the employers in the area in terms of what they're looking for, what types of internships and positions they have available. If they already have an established relationship with that employer, they have connections in that employer that they can connect you with right away, they may be able to make connections with employers that don't necessarily come here. As Tarita mentioned earlier on, it's a smaller school, so not all of the employers come directly to your campus to interview on campus to look for interns and full-time hires, but they still are open to taking connections from your career development office, and they as an office can do some research with you or direct you in the right path to find out more information about different employers, even if they don't necessarily come to Calvin to recruit on campus. You want to be aware as you're thinking about what you want to do and you're thinking about your internships and you're thinking about your job opportunities, you want to start to really research the industry and the different companies that fall within that industry so that you have a good understanding of what types of internship or job opportunities they provide. A lot of employers have what we call more structured internship programs, and other companies hire interns, but it's less structure to it and it's more of an unstructured internship. And so I always recommend if you can find within your industry employers that have a structured internship program, those are ideal because they as a company put a lot of time, effort, and energy into putting together a truly structured internship program that's going to give you a great experience as an intern. So I don't know if any of you have already had internship experience, but I hear horror stories of people who land great interns, great internships, but they sat in an office and entered data into a computer all day, or they sat at a copy machine and just made copies all day, or sat and did filing. And those are good things, those are necessary things that a lot of jobs entail certain aspects of that. But you walk away from that internship and you might not, what real value did you gain from that internship? And on the flip side, what real value did you add to that company, right? Because you guys have so much information and you have so much energy and you have so much to offer a company. So those less structured internships are great, and I would advise if you ever find yourself in that situation where you're in a less structured internship and you feel like you're not doing a lot, feel free to talk to whoever is supervising you and let them know, hey, I really would like to get some additional opportunities to get some exposure to other things, just to ask. But you really wanna shoot for or look for companies that have those structured internship programs. 9 times out of 10, when a company has a structured internship program, they use that internship program as a feeder into their entry-level full-time hiring. And so it's more than just an internship in those companies. It's a 10 to 12 week job interview. And if it goes well, you could walk away from that internship with an offer to join them for a full-time position once you graduate. So understand the difference between structured internships and unstructured internship programs. And kind of get an idea for what companies in the industry that you're looking may have those types of opportunities for you because they're really great opportunities. And the career service, the career development office will help you all to be able to get some of that information as well. The next thing which ties into the career development office would be career fairs, and that's on the list as well. So career fairs are very important. A lot of companies attend career fairs here on Calvin's campus. I would say when you're thinking about going to a career fair, that's a good opportunity for you to connect to find an internship or a job. Be intentional. Be intentional about going to that career fair. Do your research ahead of time. Know what companies are coming to that career fair and know what companies you want to talk to. Understand those companies, what their dress or attire is. If you are going to a career fair because you want to work at a bank, you want to come suited up. If you're going, and I've seen at career fairs more of, a different route where we've been at career fairs and we have a booth for, my Abercrombie and Fitch, and they've got on their khakis and they've got on polos. And so if you approach them at their booth and you've got on your khakis and your polo shirt, that's probably acceptable. But if I'm on the other side and I'm KeyBank, or I'm in a financial services institution, or if I'm a corporate entity and you come to our booth with the khakis and a polo, it doesn't really match what we're looking for in candidates. And so be intentional about understanding what your desires are when you get to that career fair and make sure that you dress accordingly and that you're prepared. Have your resumes on hand. Make sure that your resumes are up to par. Your resumes are very important. No errors on your resumes, that's a big, big no-no. If you do have objectives on your resumes, you want to be sure that you're checking those and double checking those and triple checking those. Because if I work for Meijer and you show up at my career fair booth and you give me a resume that in the objective says you just cannot wait to work for Walmart, the chances of me calling you back are going to be slim to none. So definitely if you put the objectives on your resume, make sure you're checking those, double checking those, triple checking those, and check and have other people utilize the career development office, have them check your resume for you, make sure that there's no errors again. Make sure that at your stage, your resume should be one page, unless you have more of like a CV. And again, so that goes back to being knowledgeable and doing research and understanding what's required for the certain industry that you plan to go into. But if you just have a regular resume, one page should be sufficient. And if your GPA is above 3.0, we usually say, then you should have it on there. I've met students who, in conversation, found out that they had a 4.0 and it wasn't on their resume. I'm like, what are you doing? Get that on your resume. I'm a recruiter. I need to know that. Because that's almost a guaranteed callback in my book, you know. So make sure you have your resume together, you're intentional, you show up to that career fair with a game plan, and when you are, most important thing, when you're going to show up to the career fair, you're going to approach the table, be very intentional and be prepared. So I need another volunteer. I need someone to volunteer to play me in this scenario. Let's go. Okay. So you're me, you're gonna stand here, we're gonna pretend this is a career fair booth, nice Meijer banner, and you're me, so you're the recruiter. And so I'm the candidate, so this is candidate A, what not to do at a career fair. So, Meijer, what kind of jobs you got?
Happens all the time.
All right, so. That was a demonstration, not how to approach recruiters at a career fair. And it happens, like Tarita said, all the time. And it's a big pet peeve of ours, because what does that say to me? That says to me that you didn't research what Meijer has, because you're asking me, you have no idea. The body language, you know, it tells me that you're not poised and professional. And it's just not the right impression that you want to make at a career fair. So appropriate way to approach me at a career fair would be, hi Becky, my name is Carmelita. How are you?
I'm good, how are you?
Good, I was researching on your website and I saw that you have some internship opportunities available. I major in sales and marketing right now and I'm interested in a potential opportunity coming this summer. Could you tell me a little bit more about your recruiting process and what I need to do to be considered for these jobs?
I can't tell you because I don't know.
Good job. Do you see the difference? And so be intentional. Make sure that you have your elevator speech or how you're going to introduce yourself and the question that you're going to ask. You want to make sure that you're introducing yourself briefly with a quick elevator speech. You're acknowledging that you're knowledgeable about the company and then you're asking a question. So my question to you is not, hey, do you got any jobs? What jobs do you have? My question is, this is my major, this is what I'm interested in. Tell me about what I need to do to be considered for those types of opportunities. So be prepared when you approach those tables, please. It goes a long way, first impression goes a long way. And recruiters are taking notes, so when you approach them and you give them your resume, when you walk away, they take some type of notation, and if it's good and they, you know, want to make sure that they call you back, because they're walking away from that career fair sometimes with hundreds of resumes. And so they are making notes and starring the ones that they know they want to reach back out to, or making negative comments on the ones where that really wasn't a great interaction. Okay, the other thing I wanted to mention around the career fairs is we've been doing some new things too, and I don't know if you guys have seen it, but there's virtual career fairs now too. And we've done a couple of those at Meijer, and so keep an eye out for if the schools or the industries or the employers that you're interested in are not coming to campus, keep an eye out online to see if there's any virtual career fairs that the companies that you're interested in are attending that you can be a part of. And it's just pretty much an online career fair. So each company gets a booth and then you just wait in line and it pops up and it's just a chat and you just type and ask questions back and forth. So keep an eye out for those types of opportunities. There'll probably be more of those coming down the line. Understand in working through your career development office, it's important to understand timing for when to look for a job or an internship. If you're in a four-year program, not the best thing to wait until 3 months before you graduate to say, hey, I need an internship, right? Understand that there are schedules that companies are following in terms of when they're coming to campus and when they're looking to fill their internship programs or their full-time job openings. And so they're either usually on a fall calendar or on a spring calendar, sometimes more for the internships. But the Career Development Office can always connect with you guys to make sure that you understand when companies are coming to campus so that you can be prepared. And a lot of companies are not taking interns until they're in their junior or senior year. But that doesn't mean that you don't do anything during your freshman and sophomore year in terms of looking for those internships and jobs, because you can begin to build relationships with those companies early on. If I come to campus and I see you your freshman year and I meet you and you're well poised and you come to my table and you present yourself the right way and I say, man, that's going to be that kid's a star. That person's going to be a couple years down the line, they're going to be good to go. I may flag that, and then if I see you the next year and you've done more and your resume is getting a little bit beefed up, I just get excited about the potential for the following year when we're ready to take you and you've already built those connections. So by the time it's the junior year, you might show up to the booth and you already know the recruiter. You're like, hey, it's me again. I'm ready. Hire me. So definitely don't wait until your junior year to start building relationships and networking and looking for and researching and understanding kind of what internship you want to have. There are a lot of companies that maybe take younger internships or interns that are in their lower class levels. So again, be sure to do the research up front and know what types of opportunities there are. It's probably another pet peeve of mine. This is just a side note while I'm thinking of it. Another pet peeve of mine, though, is if you're a freshman and I tell you that our internship program, we only hire juniors, but you think that you're going to be so great and you're going to change my mind and you're going to convince me that you're going to be the first freshman that we're going to hire. And it's good to have enthusiasm and it's good to show that you have that drive and motivation. But know when to back off and know when to say, okay, can we just stay connected? Can we begin to build a relationship so that when I'm ready, we can have that discussion? And then searching online, you can see a couple of our things include online searches. So as an employer at Meijer, when we post our positions on Meijer.com, jobs.meijer.com, we have automatic feeds that go out to LinkedIn, Indeed, Simply Hired, and a lot of the other smaller sites. And so definitely want to be engaging online and searching directly through the company's websites, or searching through LinkedIn to see what types of internships and job opportunities are available, or sites like Indeed. Those are the top for me right now. Every time I talk to candidates, they're finding us on LinkedIn or Indeed. And companies follow what the candidates are doing. So we kind of survey and understand where candidates are going to look for jobs, and then we make sure to put our jobs out there. So I would say those are the big things would be either directly on the company website, LinkedIn, Indeed.com, or through your school site. Any questions so far?
What is appropriate to know? So the example you gave about freshman approaching an employer who's looking for juniors, when is it appropriate to kind of push a little, and when is it appropriate to back off?
A good question to ask would be, instead of just saying, do you hire freshmen into your internship programs, the answer may be yes or no. If they say no, we don't, you might ask, have you ever made an exception for that in the past? If they say from time to time we might, then the door is open for you to have some conversation to negotiate and see if it's something that may be worth talking about. If they say no, we only can take juniors, and we don't make any exceptions, then it's probably not going to be worth it to continue to keep having that conversation, because a lot of companies, if that's what they say they stick to it, and there's no way to make an exception. Anything else? The last bullet that I wanted to talk about is alumni. connections and just in general networking. So into Rita's presentation, I think she said last year alone in the U.S., there's 500, over 500 Calvin alums across the United States at different companies. And so definitely tap into that network. Definitely don't always wait until you're an alum either to get engaged with the Calvin alums. Feel free to start reaching out now. As you're doing research, the Career Services Office is a great tool for you. The alums are a good tool as well. So if you're researching possibilities of what you think you might want to do and you see that someone works at Google that went to Calvin and graduated last year, reach out through LinkedIn and see if they have a minute to connect with you so that you can bounce some ideas off of them or get some feedback from them, because that can be very, very beneficial and helpful to you. And when people graduate and leave a school, they're usually proud of the school that they went to, and they're usually very happy and excited to help you to be able to embark upon your career search as well. So leverage the network association as much as you can. Networking in general is very, very, very important. As a recruiter, we get hundreds and hundreds of resumes sometimes, and so you can be really, really strong. And as a recruiter, I just maybe never got to your resume. Because sometimes if I've posted a position and gotten 360 resumes, I don't have time or capacity to look at all 360. So we have searching mechanisms and ways for us to get through those resumes and narrow it down to the top resumes that I think I want to look at. And so you could be really strong, your resume could be together, and it could be really good, but it may not be viewed by the recruiter. And so a good way to ensure that your resume is getting looked at is by networking and networking and networking. Because if I have 500 resumes in a requisition, and then I get an email from someone working at Meijer that used to go to Calvin, and they say, hey, I know this guy, John Smith, and he's at Calvin right now, and I graduated from Calvin last year, and I was on a project with him, and I think he's really solid talent. I think you should take a look at his resume. As soon as I get that email, what am I gonna do? I'm gonna go to the requisition, and I'm gonna search for John Smith, and I'm gonna take a look at his resume, where it might not have made it, you know, to the top of the list had I not gotten that email. So networking is very, very, very important in making sure that someone gets your resume right in front of that recruiter. Because you have to be seen. You can have the best resume, but it has to be seen.
Can you tell them a little bit more of that backdrop where, like for instance, tell them what your rec load is today, and I want you to drive this a little bit so they can how the back working works.
Yes. So today, right now, I have about 15 openings at various levels at Meijer. There's been times in the past, within the last couple of years, where I've had 30 openings at a time. And so if I have 30 positions that I'm trying to fill at a time, and I'm getting at least 100 to 200, sometimes more, resumes in each requisition, I don't have time or capacity to look at all resumes. It's just not doable. I would like to, and if I had a lower rec load, and sometimes, you know, when I'm at about 15 right now, sometimes I post a position and I'll only get about 50 resumes, and I may be able to make it through all 50 of those, but it's a quick look through. I can look at a resume in 3 seconds and know if it's something I'm gonna keep looking at or if I'm gonna put it in the no pile. So your resume really has to be concise, on point. You want it to be a clear format. I still get resumes where it's just like all straight text, no bulleting, no nothing. It's better for me to look at a resume and I can right away see the name of the school, the degree, the GPA if it's higher than 3.0. I can see where they work, the company, and I can see the years. And it's clearly separated and defined, so I can just look at it in one quick second and know if it's a resume that I want to look into deeper.
Is it recommended or frowned upon to get a picture of your face on your resume?
Yeah, I work in HR, so I'm a no-no for the pictures. When I get resume with pictures, I take it off before I send it to my hiring managers, because I don't want my hiring managers looking at you and making any snap judgments. I don't want them to have any biases because you're a female or because you have blonde hair or because you're African American or because you're Hispanic or Asian. I don't want them to see your picture because I don't want them making any snap judgments. Not that they should, or not that I believe that they will, but I'm not going to give them that opportunity. So for HR, we tend to cringe when we see photos. We're like, no, don't put that on there. So I don't recommend photos on the resumes.
Could you talk a little bit about how your computer system will have certain ones come up for you to review and others not?
Yes, so we can put filters in our system. So we may get 200 applications. We can sort by different keywords, and we can sort by different fields that you entered into your application. So if there's a series of questions, we call them ACE questions. If there's a series of questions that are a part of your application, maybe it asks you to, is your GPA 3.0 or higher? Or do you have a degree? What is your major? Those types of questions, when you put that information into the system, we can use that information to sort through resumes. And so then I'm only looking at the people who answered the questions the way that I want them to. But when you know that on the candidate side, you still have to be honest, because I also get candidates who will answer the question the way that I think that they should in order for me to look at their resume. But then when I look at their resume, they clearly didn't meet those requirements that I asked. So I think candidates sometimes figure out, if I answer these questions the right way, they'll look at my resume and then they'll just fall in love with me and they'll call me even if I don't meet the requirements. But for that particular job, they ask those questions for a reason. And so just always be honest on those application questions, but know that recruiters have ways to field through hundreds of resumes to make sure that they're looking at the ones that they want to look at, the ones that match the requirements to do the job that they're looking to fill.
How important or not important is a cover letter?
I think it's going to vary depending upon the industry. And I can only speak for myself, but I don't most of the time read cover letters. I know other recruiters who do, but I'm trying to look at 500 resumes, so I don't necessarily have time to read a cover letter. I do know, though, that there are certain industries and certain job postings where they ask you for a cover letter, and in those instances, always provide it. But if you applied for a position that didn't require or ask for a cover letter and you don't provide one, it's not going to hurt your chances of getting viewed. In my opinion, there may be other recruiters who disagree, but.
I know this varies like by employer, but is there usually like a general window when employers start looking for fall jobs, internships to hire for and stuff?
Mm-hmm. Yes, so they usually are on a fall or spring recruiting cycle. And so if I'm thinking back to my campus times, I do experience hiring now, but when I did campus hiring, if we would hit the campuses in the fall, and at that point we were even trying to get there before, you know, right when school started. So in the fall, we're looking for individuals who are going to be ready to go in the summer for internships. And we're looking to fill them, I think we used to say by April. We would hope to have those internships filled that are starting that summer.
If it was full-time jobs, it would be by December.
So, yeah.
But it does vary by industry. And like she said, some companies don't have their headcount together, so some don't start until the spring. But remember that you, whatever the semester is, you want to start at the beginning of that semester. Like right now, we can still help you in our office if you're looking today. But right now it's late for a lot of places, but there are still openings.
Yeah, so it's the fall or the spring. Some companies will do their full-time hiring in the fall and save their internship hiring for the spring semester. Some companies do their fall in there, start the fall and start the spring, start the internship recruiting right in the fall as well. So it does vary by company and by industry. But you have to be ahead of the game. Any other questions?
This is a question going back to networking. I'm in this unique position where I got a freelance job at this firm, where they call me when they need work and they haven't been communicating for a long time, and usually I'm the one who initiates communications to see if they need me at all. I guess my question is, how much should I keep on trying to keep in contact with them, or should I just kind of?
I would say it's going to depend on you and what you're looking to do. So my initial reaction was, is the company just using you? So when you reach out to them, they're like, oh great, we need help, let's get her to do this, which is fine if it's helping you. So I would just say, be fair to yourself. If it's something that is beneficial to you and it's helpful for you to get that experience and you need and want that experience, then I would, as long as they're willing to get back to you and let you help them, I would keep asking. Until they say otherwise, I would just keep doing it. It's gonna be totally up to you what you're looking for. And if that work is beneficial and helpful to you, I would say feel free to keep reaching out until they tell you otherwise. Yeah, it's fine to follow up. When we decline candidates for jobs or internships, we always tell candidates, I tell candidates all the time, hey, we decided to move forward with someone else for this position. However, please feel free to keep my contact information and let me know if you see anything else out there that you might be a fit for, because we like to consider you in the future. And so I leave it in there. The ball is then in their court for them to connect with me. If they're really, really strong, and I do have a file of people that I will go back to say, hey, we didn't offer you before, but now I have this great opportunity. That's what we call pipelining on the recruiting side. And so I do have a file of pipeline candidates that I can go back to. But I would say on your end, don't wait for them to come back to you. If you see something else that you're interested in, feel free to reach back out, and it's fine. I don't have any issue with that. If you reach back out and we can connect again, I would say feel free to continue to keep that contact with them.
I have a question.
So if you, I'll just use myself because I'm in that situation. So if I'm applying for international admissions internships, but there are none that I kind of want to do, but I see something like on human resources, how far do you think you should go in terms of applying for internships that are somewhat similar to personal? Mm-hmm.
I would say, first off, some internship is better than no internship, right? So if you're in a situation where you're definitely not finding anything in that specific field, and you get to the point where you do want to expand your search out a little bit, I don't think there's anything wrong with that. I would just say to get some guidance or some assistance in just making sure that it's not a position that's way in left field. You want to try to get something that, even though it's not the exact match to your industry, it's going to be something that you'll be able to take something from that internship and apply it to once you go back into your industry. You want it to be applicable or at least have transferable skills. So transferable skills, did that answer your question before I move on? Okay, good. So transferable skills is a big thing for me when talking to college students, because sometimes you don't have the exact experience that's necessary for a job or an internship, but you may have extracurricular, or I heard somebody told me today, you guys call it co-curricular activities. If you have those types of things on your resume, be prepared and able to articulate, although I don't have the necessary, or although I don't have the exact match, or if you in this case had an internship that was in a different industry, although I recognize that my internship was not in this exact industry, let me explain to you, or let me walk you through how I gained these skills and how I think that they're applicable to this industry. And so be able to articulate your transferable skills and how something that is either from a different industry or from your own personal life. I've used examples, I'm a single mother. I've used examples in a job interview about being a single mother because I didn't have an example to demonstrate to that person a certain skill set. I said, well, although I haven't had an opportunity to do that in the workplace, let me tell you about this example. As a single mother, I had to do X, Y, and Z. And so I was able to take something that's a transferable skill and show how it's not here in the corporate environment, but what I did in that example is transferable and can demonstrate that I'm going to be able to perform in this corporate environment.
Can you talk a
talk to them a little bit about, LinkedIn is doing a lot now to reach college students. A lot of companies are now reaching out to LinkedIn college students. Can you talk to them a little bit about sourcing and why this is important for them?
Yeah, so LinkedIn is huge for recruiters. Right now we have, you all have LinkedIn access to LinkedIn, but recruiters have recruiter access to LinkedIn. And so we don't have to be connected to you all to see your profile. We have access to all profiles in LinkedIn, and we have search features where we can go in and search for certain things, advanced searches where we can pull up the profiles that we're looking for. And so a lot of recruiters, most recruiters are using LinkedIn Recruiter to search for people. And so I think in the past, it was more of a professional experience networking site. But more and more now, we're seeing and trying to get college students to get their LinkedIn profile created and updated early on, and utilizing that as a tool on the campuses. So definitely very important to get your LinkedIn updated. Any other questions about anything overall? I love opportunities to get in front of you guys and help you on this end before you get in front of that employer or before you get in front of that interviewer.
As a recruiter, what kinds of things for a student would you look for on a LinkedIn profile?
So as I'm not doing the campus recruiting space right now, so my hires right now are more experienced, but I would say if I were to go onto LinkedIn to look for college students, I would say definitely any work experience that you've had. And if you're in your freshman or sophomore year, if that experience was in high school, I would say it's still relevant, so go ahead and keep it on there. Any work experience, any co-curricular activities that you're doing, if you hold leadership positions, and if you're still in your junior, sophomore year, or if you're in your junior or senior year, you should always try to get those leadership positions in those activities. So it's good to be members of things, but whenever you can get a leadership position within an organization, it looks really good on your resume or on your LinkedIn profile. So I would say any leadership type positions that you've held. Going back to the volunteer thing, I think it's important if you don't have the work experience or previous internship experience, you can put the volunteer work that you do because that's demonstrating certain skill sets. Even if you want to keep it a little bit vague because you don't necessarily want to put all your personal things that you're involved in, you can keep it vague, but put something to show that you're active. We want to see that you're active. We want to see that there's not gaps where it appears that you might not be doing anything. We want to see that you're having leadership capabilities. We want to see that you're engaged and involved.
Yeah, Leslie, I know we have some in the room. This, I think, will be helpful for everybody. So now they've got the internship and they're in there. How do they navigate the corporate or company or organizational landscape so that they can?
Yes, so as an intern coming into any organization, very important to, I know sometimes interns come in and you're engaged, you're excited, you're enthusiastic, you want to save the world, do so much, but really take the time to just breathe it all in and to just acclimate into the culture of the organization, understand the culture of the organization, understand the person that you're reporting into, understand what their communication style is, understand what communication style works best with them. We do a lot on campus, on our corporate campus around educating our employers, our team members, on working with multi-generations in the workplace. And so I would say be mindful of that, because when you're coming into an organization and you're dealing with different generations, they have different communication styles. And I know for you all, texting is like second nature to you guys, right? But you might be reporting into others who don't necessarily text. And so ask your manager or your supervisor up front, what is the best way for me to communicate with you? So that you understand if email is best for them, or if picking up the phone and calling them is best for them, or if they're okay with text messaging. So get an idea for the corporate culture, get an idea for the person that you're reporting into, what their communication style is and what preferences they have. understand from them what the expectations are for you. More of the structured internship programs, they'll be very good about spelling out for you what the expectations are as an intern. Others may not, so definitely don't hesitate to ask, what are the expectations of me as an intern here? What are you guys looking for me to do so that I can make sure I meet those expectations? Yes.
Do you prefer student athletes or?
Yes, not prefer, but it's that's goes in line with extracurricular activities. So if you're a student athlete, definitely put that on your resume because that shows that although you might not have a part-time job or you might not have an internship, we understand that a lot goes into that sometimes. And so there's that's hours that you're putting in. That means that you probably have good teamwork. That means that you can handle commitment and that you there's a lot of transferable skills that you can take away from that. So that is big. And if you're a captain or co-captain or a leadership position on those teams, that's helpful too. Good point.
Well, thank you. Thanks, Carmelita.
Thank you.